New general manager of the Knicks. Steve, welcome. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic, Mike. How are you?
Good, thank you. All right, a couple of things here. First, surprising timing. Were you surprised by the timing of this announcement right as you're about to start your training camp and start your season? I mean, what was with the timing of this announcement?
You know, I'm not really sure why Jim chose the timing that he did. He approached me and said he wanted to talk to me about some things that were going on within the Knicks organization. We had meetings, and he told me about his desire to build out the basketball side of the organization. I'm not sure why the timing was what it is, but I think given what he wanted to try to get accomplished, it's going to be one of those situations where there are not going to be any issues about, you know, me transitioning into working with Mike Woodson or being involved with the players. I don't think there'll be any disruption issues as it relates to that.
What will Grunwald's role be?
Glenn will remain on as an advisor to me to help, you know, brief me on things that have been going on in the organization, answer questions and give me some advice on things that I feel like I need to lean on him a little bit for, but he'll be an advisor to me.
Will there be different people now involved in player assessment and player procurement, or will it be the same people but just different roles?
You know, I'm not sure yet. One of the things that Jim has asked me to do is really take a look at this organization from top to bottom and make an assessment as to what I think we need to do in terms of maybe modifying what people currently do or potentially bringing in new people to create an organization that is one of the best basketball organizations in the NBA. So in some cases, I mean, we have, you know, Mark Warkentin has a great history in player evaluation. I mean, he's executive of the year. John Gabriel was an executive of the year. We have Allen Houston, who I've known for a long time and I think is an up-and-coming executive. I want to look at what everyone is doing and make sure that we are using the right people, using analytics, the right things to develop our players and treat our players when they're hurt, the right approaches to scouting and how we look at NBA prospects. So I'm going to look at everybody that's here, probably reorganize them in a different fashion, and see where we think we need to add some people to make our organization complete.
All right, so you have intentions on changing the organization. In what way?
I think that, you know, we have to take a different look in incorporating analytics into how we approach player evaluation and potential trades. I think the NBA, in my opinion, in some cases, has shifted too far in analytics driving the entire process. I think we have an opportunity to sort of find the right balance between where you have a guy who's a pure player evaluator in terms of what he sees and how we combine that with analytics to get
all right,
us
so
to
you're
the
talking
right
the system. Same marriage that baseball has had a tap dance, the old scout who watches with his eyes versus the guy who buys into all the saber-tician numbers. You're talking the same thing with all these new, and the NBA has as many numbers as baseball has, tremendous amount of numbers now. You want to use them, but you also want to use the guy who can see a player with his eyes, right?
Mike, you're dead on. You've been around this. You've seen it. One of the things that, you know, and when I was at the Garden before, one of the things that I would see when I, even though the scouts weren't my responsibility, I would sit in a scout meeting, and the observation that I made was that the scout that was the best salesman won. And I think we need to find a way to sort of find the guy who has the best eye and then also use analytics to help us get to the right decision.
Are you now, a lot of the stuff that's been said in the last couple of days makes it sound like you're an administrator and not a basketball guy. Now, I don't know you that well, but I know this. You're Ollie Mills' son, and I knew Ollie Mills. Now, Ollie Mills was a legendary high school coach, so you grew up in a basketball family, and your father was a legendary high school coach, so you know a little bit about basketball, obviously, because you grew up in a basketball household.
Mike, I think that's one of the things that if you ask anyone who really knows me, They know I come from basketball and a coaching culture.
Your father was a big coach.
If you go out to Hempstead High School, you go to the football stadium, the football field, and it's named after my uncle Charlie Mills. You go to the gymnasium, it's named after my dad. My dad was definitely the first coach in Long Island to win a championship coaching both boys and girls.
Great coach. Ollie Mills was a legendary coach on Long Island. Coached when I was around in those days and in high school and stuff. Coached against the same league as my younger brother, who's gone now. Coached against him. And I knew your father a little bit, and he was a great, like I said, he's a legendary high school coach. What did you learn from your father?
Well, you know, I started going to games with my father, not games, practices, when I was 5 years old and 10 years old. I was sitting on the bench with him, and I learned about accountability. My dad had a player on his team, and this guy spoke at my dad's funeral. It was the night before my father's first opportunity to win a Nassau County championship, and the guy got into a fight at a party that he wasn't supposed to be at. And my father suspended him for the championship game, and they lost. And this kid was an All-American player. And so that taught me a lot about accountability. Now, that's one of those things I'll never forget. And this guy talked about that story at my dad's funeral.